There's a Stanley plane sitting right there. Grab it for me, please.
Okay, we're good now.
It's right there in the end of that table. We're back on?
Yeah, the audio's working.
We're good?
Yeah.
Give me a yes. So I start over? Didn't hear any of that? Hi, folks. Welcome. I'm Rob Cosman. This is my shop, and this is our Saturday night, thank you, live YouTube workshop that we do every second Saturday night. Tonight's theme is on building wood hinge boxes. So we've already had a call out for questions, and we've got several pages of them. We'll also take ones live if you're interested. We've got a very special program tonight. I'll just briefly tell you that we also use this as a means of raising awareness and financing our Purple Heart Project, where we bring combat wounded veterans in 6 times a year and treat them to a 6-day, very intense, hand-to-a-woodworking training. We cover all their expenses, airfare, hotel meals. We send each vet home with approximately, in U.S. dollars, $3,500 worth of premium tools. And when they're waiting, thanks to the bench brigade, or when they're arriving at home, there'll be a bench waiting for them that has been built, and delivered by a civilian volunteer, all headed up by Jack down in Texas. And Rob White, good friend of mine, one of our vets from the very first workshop, should have had his delivered sometime earlier today. Now, we're doing things a little bit different than we normally do. As I said, we have if you're a patriot of any country that appreciates freedom, we have something tonight that may never be duplicated again. It is a treat. You are going to be so grateful that you were on here. And in the few minutes it's going to take us to get it together, we're just going to handle some questions. And when we're ready to go, we will do it. Questions?
Where did you put them?
I never printed them off.
You didn't?
I thought you said Luther had them.
I thought you were looking at them.
Well, if somebody finds the questions, I'll go through and introduce the whole concept. So I got lots of boxes sitting in front of me. So what we do, or what I was first taught this principle by Dr. Dale Nish at Brigham Young University back in 1983. And when I saw it, I just thought, that has got to be the coolest thing I have ever seen. So it's a means of hinging a lid with wood. So that, in fact, let me show you one of my better ones. This is a really good one. This is out of walnut. It's almost invisible until you open it. And then all of a sudden, this thing appears. And when you close it, it disappears. It's nice and clean on the inside. Well, I took that and ran with it. I've made well over 1,000. I think I'm close to 2,000 of these boxes over the years. But I also developed a jig to be able to make them more accurately. And I'll explain to you what I mean in a moment. I'll just show you some of the ones that we got here. This one's made out of Mexican rosewood and bird's eye. And this is a business card box. It fits and holds your business cards. Makes a great little thing to put on your desk. Great conversation starter if you need to start a conversation with someone in your office. We do multiple different sizes. And we also do different numbers of pins. Here's what I'm going to explain to you. So this is a 3-pin. 1, 2, 3. This one is a 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's 5 different pieces. This one, I think, is a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. This is a 9-pin. And the more pins you put in, the more intricate it becomes. Now, we also use it. I'll try to show you later tonight. You can actually use this on furniture as well. And to give you some idea how it works, I was just working on a box today. This is made out of Bastogne walnut and figured maple. So the back of the box has a groove. Let me know when you find them. Has a groove cut in it. So in order to cut that groove, you use something called a core box bit. And I'll show you what that looks like. Core box bit, and they have to be accurate, cuts a perfect half circle. So this is a 1/4 inch. So it's a 1/4 inch diameter. Radius would be 1/8 of an inch. And that is used to go in there and make that cut. Now, this is my little setup. Very, very crude. I'll come over here, Jake. So I've got a router mounted in the table. There's your bit. There's a lot to it, and we'll explain it later. But you expose a part of the bit coming up from the bottom, and you expose part of the bit coming from the side. And you put that groove in the back of your box, and then the lid has the same cut made, only you lay the lid flat when you do it. Now, I'm going to kind of skip over this a little bit and just get right to the meat of it. So you end up with a dowel that's in like this, piece of wooden dowel. You cut it into segments. You drill a hole in the end of each segment. You only have to drill it in about an eighth of an inch. You put it all back together using a piece of welding rod. So we use this 16th-inch welding rod, and we snip it into little quarter-inch pieces. It doesn't go all the way through. And each piece is in between each segment. When you put the dowel in place, after measuring carefully and cutting it into the different segments, you glue the whole thing together. The center of the dowel is actually inside of the back of the box, so that after you've glued it together and flushed it off, you don't expose those pins, and you end up with that nice, neat look when you open the lid.
All right, we're ready.
All right, so that's the introduction. And by the way, we give away a whole lot of stuff during these. We got lots of prizes tonight, and I'll tell you more about that in a little bit.
All right, so this first question comes all the way from Hamburg, Germany.
Hamburg, Germany.
And
I don't sprechen Sie Deutsch.
I'm sure that's how it's pronounced, too. Hamburg.
Well, that's Luther's.
Anyway, it's from Patrick, and he says, can the wood hinge also be used for deep cabinet doors? If so, how much load can the hinge take? Example, if the door is full of tools.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a little bit different. Let me just show you this real quick in answering that question. Can't hide this shirt because it's part of what we're giving away tonight. So here is a piece of furniture that we're working on. This is called a standing desk. And the lid, if you get in there real close, Jake, where do you want me? The lid is the wood hinge. So if you look on here on the end, now what do we use on this half inch? Right? Now your strength, if you think about it, your strength is going to come from how strong is a glue joint between two pieces of wood? Well, we know for a fact that it's actually stronger than the wood itself. The more segments you have, the more contact you have of that little steel pin in between the two pieces. Something else you have to take into, this is going to be a bit of a long answer because there's a lot of things that come into play. When you're setting up your jig for cutting the groove, you have the option, over here, Jake, please. You have the option of where you place your fence. So if I were to push the fence in this direction, that would result in more wood on the outside. Actually, I gotta do this. Okay, I need a drill. Tell me when we need to switch gears, Frick.
We'll do it right after this question.
Okay. So here's the jig. We'll talk about it a little bit more later, but I'm just going to go in and do a sample. Okay. So what I just did is I drilled a hole in the end of that jig. The more wood that we have, you know, when we flush it off, let's say we flush it off and we remove this part, the more wood we have on the outside of that, the stronger the joint's going to be. But the farther in you move the center of the dowel, the less range you're going to have with your lid. So there's lots of things to factor in. I would say that it would be equally, I've done it on one set of cabinet doors. I've done it on blanket boxes, fairly large. And the one I'm thinking of, I built back in 1988, and it's still as good as the day it was built. So if you go with the 3/4 in the kit, now I don't want to turn this into a commercial, but in the kit that we sell, there are two holders and 4 receivers. Here's what I mean. So that's a holder. That holds a 16th inch drill bit. And this holder holds an 1/8 inch drill bit. You have set screws right there to position it wherever you want. And then you have a 3/4 inch receiver, a half inch receiver, a 3/8, and a 1/4. So that allows you to make your your hinge stock in whatever size that you want. Now, if I was using it, doing it in 3/4, I would want to have an 1/8-inch pin. And that's going to make for a pretty strong joint. So if you're using a 3/4 dowel on there, the more segments you have, the stronger it is. I can't see that being a problem at all. So I think I'd say go for it. Okay.
All right.
So put this on hold for a moment. I'm going to tell you, I'll give you a brief introduction of what we're going to do, and then I want you just to sit there and enjoy this. I get lots of emails that I respond to. I try to always respond to, and I got one about a month ago from a man named John. And John said, Rob, I love watching your stuff, your YouTube stuff. He said, I'm wondering if you would do me a favor. He said, my dad is 95 years old. He's in failing health. He's a World War II vet, and would it be possible for you to give him a shout-out during your next live broadcast? I think it might really raise his spirits. I read that, and I said, oh, my goodness, are you kidding me? World War II vet, we can do a whole lot better than a shout-out. So you have to enter, you have to meet my my right hand and my left hand, and I have lots of hands in this, but this man right here...
Fortunately, not your face.
This man right here is retired Colonel Luther Sheely, U.S. Army Artillery. This is Super Dave Benson, his son from a different mother. And Luther is Luther has tons of experience in this. He's recently retired. He's actually one that alerted me to this, and we said, let's see what we can do. So Herman, who is the World War II vet that we're going to meet quite shortly, was part of the hombres, the tough hombres. Now, that was a division that was made up among mostly recruits from Texas and Oklahoma. So their patch is a T with an O on the bottom. And Herman landed D-Day. Actually, I'm telling you too much because this is all going to be done, so Luther's going to be mad at me. Make a long story short, we wanted to really bring... Herman's sacrifice to the attention of everyone and give everyone the opportunity to actually say something to him through text, but to hear from this man and to let him know how much we appreciate him and respect what he's done. So without any further ado, are we ready to roll that? So I'm going to turn this over to some research that Colonel Luther did. It's about a 10-minute clip, and you're going to hear all about Herman and what he did in 1944. Roll.
Here at Rob Cosman Woodworking, we make it our mission to honor the men and women of the armed forces, past and present. We are particularly proud to honor those who served in World War II. We call them the greatest generation. As Veterans Day approaches, we wanted to take a moment tonight to honor all servicemen by telling the story of a few of the greatest generation who served in the 90th Infantry Division and fought in World War II. Giuseppe and Assunto Di Maio immigrated to the U.S. from Italy, settled in New York, and had 9 children, 5 boys and 4 girls. 4 of the boys would serve in the military and fight in World War II. The oldest, Ralph, joined the Army Air Corps and served in the Mediterranean Theater of Operations. Nick joined the Army, becoming an infantryman, and served throughout the war. In 1943, Lou and Herman followed their brothers into the military and became infantrymen. In January of 1944, they were assigned to the 90th Infantry Division, then located at Camp Dix, New Jersey. The 90th Infantry Division was a proud World War I division, originally composed of recruits from the states of Texas and Oklahoma. Thus, their patch was a combination of a letter T and a letter O. They had earned a fearsome reputation and were known as the tough hombres. On March 22, 1944, the division arrived in New York City, boarded troop ships, and sailed for England. Arriving in England in early April of 1944, the division was stationed in Wales and began intensive training for the eventual invasion of Europe. 2 months later, as part of the D-Day invasion force, the division loaded onto transport ships and sailed for Utah Beach, Normandy, France. Landing on 8 June, 2 days after the D-Day invasion, the division occupied assembly areas just off Utah Beachhead. Some of the hardest fighting during the first week of the D-Day invasion took place as airborne and ground units fought to link up and gain space for follow-on units to attack through. By 10 June, the attack out of Utah Beach had only reached 9 miles inland before being stopped by German defenses along a ridge in front of the Merredeux River. Additionally, the heavy rains of June had flooded most of the area immediately behind the beaches, canalizing movement along raised roads called causeways. This was the situation that faced the newly arrived 90th Division. The tough hombres were ordered to attack across the Merredeux River, penetrate the German defenses, and seize objectives along the Dove River, some 8 miles away. Both Lou and Herman DeMaio's regiments, the 357th and the 358th respectively, attacked across the causeways and immediately ran into fierce German defenses in the famous hedgerows of Normandy. The brutal hedgerow fighting that followed was something the American units were not prepared for. Most military historians agree that the hedgerow fighting was far more difficult and bloody than the actual D-Day invasion. The hedgerow fight was defined by a series of small, brutal actions in which attacks were met by counterattacks, and real estate changed hands daily. Gains were measured in yards instead of miles, and casualties were high. Originally built by the Romans, the hedgerows were mounds of dirt raised in irregular patterns that served as fences between small plots of farmland. Hedges grown on top of the mounds formed an almost impenetrable barrier up to 16 feet high. A typical section of the battlefield averaged over 3,900 of these hedgerowed enclosures in less than 8 miles. The Germans had spent months preparing their defenses, making each enclosure a virtual fortress. In the first days of the Battle of the Hedgerows, Lou and Herman's regiments assaulted these enclosures at full speed, attempting to use velocity and violence of action to overwhelm the defenders. Instead, German machine guns, mortars, and artillery cut the tough hombres down. Soon, the 90th Division measured their gains in hundreds of yards, and each regiment averaged daily casualties of over 150 men. It was while in the hedgerows that Lou and Herman found themselves fighting side by side. Peering through a hedgerow, a German bullet whizzed within inches of Herman's head and struck Lou in the arm. Severely wounded, Lou was medically evacuated off the battlefield. Herman continued to slug it out in hedgerows without his brother. By the end of June, it was obvious to the American leadership that something had to be done to break out of the hedgerow country. And Operation Cobra, a giant aerial bombardment, was developed. In order to set the conditions for Operation Cobra, a few strategic German strong points had to be reduced. The 90th Division was assigned the mission to seize the German strong point at the village of Saint-Germain-sur-Cise. After 6 weeks of fighting in the hedgerows, the 90th Division had lost an equivalent of 100% of its assigned infantry enlisted soldiers and 150% of its infantry officers. The division now consisted of green replacements led by the few men that had survived the savage fighting, such as Herman. The village of Saint-Germain-sur-Cise was located in a low, hedgerowed mound of earth in the middle of the Cise River and was surrounded by flooded swampland. The tough hombres nicknamed this village Cise Island. A narrow road linked Cise Island to the mainland, but the Germans had destroyed the one bridge over the river, and the level, treeless swamps around the village offered neither cover nor concealment for the attacking hombres. Saint-Germain-sur-Cise was defended by entrenched, battle-hardened veterans of the German 6th Fallschirmjäger, or Paratroop Regiment. The German paratroops had excellent dug-in positions and were supported by tanks and artillery. Herman's regiment, the 358th, was chosen to make the assault on the island. Their attack commenced on July 22nd, around 06:30 a.m. After a 15-minute artillery barrage, Herman and his fellow hombres advanced towards Saint-Germain-sur-Cise along the single narrow road. The plan was to seize the area around the bridge the Germans had destroyed and construct a temporary bridge that would allow tanks to cross the swampland to the village. Initially, the attack was successful. The 358th breached the forward positions of the 6th Walsenjäger, seized the island, and pushed across the river, penetrating more than a quarter of a mile inside the German lines. Casualties were heavy, and the 358th suffered 180 men killed or wounded in the first 6 hours of the attack. The German commander, believing the Americans had come across the river with only a small reconnaissance force, ordered one company, led by Sergeant Uhlig, to counterattack, push the Americans back across the river, and to capture a couple of Americans for questioning. 800 yards to Uhlig's front were about 300 men from the 1st and the 2nd battalions of the 358th. At about 1800 hours, the German paratroopers launched their attack. After 3 hours of tough fighting, the Germans pushed the Americans back across the river and onto the island with heavy losses. As the fighting ended that evening, the Americans knew that they were in a precarious position and began digging in on the island's high ground. Luckily, the 358th had been able to bring two platoons of tanks across the temporary bridge to reinforce the island. Meanwhile, Uhlig was reinforced with three tanks, two heavy machine guns, and about 30 replacements. Uhlig positioned the machine guns to cover the open meadowland behind the island to prevent the island from being further reinforced, blocked the Americans from withdrawing, and guaranteeing that he would capture some prisoners. At 0800 on the following morning, the Germans launched their attack. The Germans were stopped by the American artillery and tanks. The Germans regrouped and attacked again. The Americans stopped the second attack as well. A third attack, however, broke through the 1st Battalion's defenses, and the weary, understrength Green Americans fell back across the island, only to run into Uhlig's machine guns. The German machine guns cut down the withdrawing GIs. Some U.S. troops managed to get through the murderous fire, but most were killed or wounded. About 200 hombres, including Herman, had no choice but to surrender. The 90th Division commander decided that taking Siv's Island by frontal attack was too costly and chose instead to bypass the island. Within 4 days, the Germans were forced to withdraw. Operation Cobra was then launched, breakout was achieved, and the Allies were racing toward Paris. The 90th Division went on to serve with distinction throughout the rest of the war. After the war, General Omar Bradley said of the division, "The 90th Infantry Division became one of the most outstanding in the European theater." As for Herman, he was held in a German prisoner of war camp for a year until it was liberated by the Russians. Incredibly, all four DeMaio brothers survived the war and were reunited back home, where they and countless members of the greatest generation went on to create one of the greatest periods of prosperity in U.S. history. Veterans Day is 11 November, and we ask that you take the time to honor and remember all veterans, past and present. Nick, Lou, and Herman all earned the Bronze Star for their service as combat infantrymen in World War II. However, because of an administration error, Nick and Herman were never awarded their medals. So tonight, the Army is correcting that mistake, and we are presenting Herman with his Bronze Star. Both Nick and Herman's official military records are being corrected.
My name is Colonel Luther Sheely, United States Army retired. It is my honor to represent the President of the United States and the Chief of Staff of the United States Army today and present this award. Attention to orders. To all who shall see these present, greetings. This is to certify that the President of the United States of America, authorized by Act of Congress, July 2nd, 1926, has awarded the Bronze Star to Corporal Herman DeMeo, who distinguished himself by meritorious achievement during combat operations in Normandy, France, Operation Overlord. During combat operations, Corporal DeMeo displayed the highest degree of professionalism, courage under fire, and leadership. His devotion to duty and untiring selfless service displayed by Corporal DeMeo reflects great credit upon himself, his fellow soldiers, the 90th Infantry Division, and the United States Army. Please present the award.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Herman, sir, it is an honor and a privilege to be in your presence.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Amongst our audience tonight, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of military veterans. And I can't tell you how much admiration they have for you and for your generation.
Thank you. On behalf of his brothers and his family,
everyone's quiet for the same reason. Herman, rest easy tonight. We all salute you. Is there anything he'd like to say in closing? How about just a big thumbs up? Thank you, Herman.
Are we back on?
We are, yep.
I need a... I got it right here. May as well be 120 grit sandpaper. So, I hope you realize the amount of work that Luther put into that. Incredible contribution. Of course, nothing we do would compare to what Herman and his brothers and those of his generation have done, and so many in future generations have done. Now, November 11th is Remembrance Day in Canada, And from between now and November, maybe even through November, we're going to try to highlight veterans like this. And next week, in two weeks' time, we're going to have one of our own, who is Ken Anthony, who's here with us tonight. His father-in-law fought in the Battle of the Bulge, and it's quite a story. And Luther has a connection to that.
John Obershaw.
And we got some great stuff coming for you. We'll try to give you some woodworking in between just to spice it up a bit. But let's go back to questions. Thank you, Herman. And thank you, John, for bringing this to our attention. You were an answer to our prayer. We were looking for some way to show our gratitude this Veterans Day, and you landed right in my lap at the perfect time. Thank you. And thank you to your family. Frick.
All right. This one comes from Ali Al-Sawad from Victoria, Australia. And he says, is there an easier way to make the dowels for a wooden hinge? For the wooden hinge.
Well, Ali, you can go out and buy. I thought I had
There's one
some
with
here.
A tag on it.
Huh? Well, that's 3/16. I thought there was some that was a little bit different. I've got some here that I purchased. There's a piece. So this is a piece of 7/16 wooden dowel. You can buy it in the store. If I run my fingers like that, I can feel a seam on both sides. And I assume that they do that with a router doing half at a time. So it doesn't come off perfectly round. And that's the reason why I prefer to make my own. The other reason, which is maybe even more important, is I'm trying to find a great example. This is a pretty good one. See, my dowel is actually made out of bird's eye. And if you want to get really clever, what you can do is when you make your box and you take this piece of wood, you actually cut a section right off of here and use that for your dowel. So literally when you put it back together, the dowel came from that piece of wood that would be right there. So that's the huge advantage in making your own dowel. But you can get by with store-bought dowel. It'll work. In fact, here's another little idea that you can employ. Lee Nielsen, I can't recommend anybody else's because I haven't used anybody else's. Lee Nielsen makes what's called a dowel plate. And this dowel plate has exactly dimensioned holes. Now that hole is, it's flared on the back side. I don't know if you can see it, but the first little bit is straight or square to the side, and then it flares into the opening. So you can take your store-bought quarter-inch dowel and drive it through, and that will perfectly size it and get rid of any variation. Now, the problem is, if you start trying to pound that through, it's going to move this way, that way, all over. So what you're going to have to do is get a piece of wood and drill a hole that's large enough diameter for this to slide through, clamp it or somehow hold it right there so that as you're pounding it through, it is going through that dowel plate perpendicular to the sides and not moving about. So when it comes out the other end, it'll still be nice and straight. So that's a way of using, getting store-bought dowel to work. Now, that's not, I don't have a piece. I was going to try to force that through a 7/16, but I only have half inch, and I don't think I have, oh yeah, I do right here. No, that's not true either. I made that. If I had some store-bought dowel, which I think this is 3/8. Well, see, that's undersized. So there's your 3/8 store-bought dowel. It's actually thinner than, or narrower than 3/8 of an inch. When you put this together, the strength of your dowel hinge is going to determine on be determined by how much good contact you have between the dowel and that groove cut in both the back and in the lid. So if you're, and that's the reason why, by the way, we choose these white side bits because they match up perfectly. They give you a true half round. It's a quarter of an inch, and it matches up with that receiver, which is a quarter of an inch. So everything is as close to being perfect as you can get it. So your option for making the dowel is buy the store-bought stuff and try to feed it through a dowel plate to perfectly size it, or go through the pain of making your own, which is what I show you Actually, we're coming out with a YouTube video here very soon on making the jig. So maybe we'll actually simplify it and make it so that you can actually do it. I got to do a little bit more work on it because I don't even quite know how this thing works. All I know is I play around with it until it finally does work. But I got to try to figure out a way so we can, I can explain to you what adjustments have to be made in order to get that to provide you with perfect dowel. And it's really cool when you get it and start feeding square stock through and it comes out the other end perfectly round. Next.
All right, this one comes from Fred Robbins in Yamhill, Oregon.
You've been there.
And he says, Fred, how do you determine what size hinge you should use on a box?
Good question. So I'll kind of give you my little bit of a rule that I follow, and I'll give you some examples. If you're dealing with... the smallest box I make is a little ring box. So if you can imagine a box that is small enough to hold a wedding ring, for that size I use quarter inch. I use quarter inch for the business card boxes. I use quarter inch for something this size, which just tell you so that you have some reference. This measures approximately 8 by 3 3/4 by 2 1/2. It's probably tied more to the thickness of your sides. And I like to keep the sides probably on the thin side as opposed to the thick side. That is 1/4 inch. 3/8 inch on a box that size to me would look too bulky. So you can't make your dowel, you can't put too big of a dowel on too narrow of a drawer side, or else this part right here is going to be too fragile. Now, the reason why that's critical, when you're doing the drawer side, have I got a piece of, I do right here. Shoot. There's a piece. When you're cutting, actually do it. Come here, Jake, we'll turn this on. I'm about to route the side of the drawer box. It's a piece of pine. And you're doing it upright like that. You have to have some material right here to prevent that piece from falling down. You can't take away the entire edge. You have to have something, so you really can't go much thinner than that. So that's one way of determining what size. And then, of course, there's the lid, the overall size of the box. Here's a jewelry box, and on this one, I've used a 3/8 dowel. And that just seems to be appropriately sized for that size of a box. I've got about a 1/16 inch material right in there. This actually was a box that is broken, and then I had to come back in. The lid got broken in half when we were moving home 30 years ago. I don't think I have another example of a bigger lid except for this one. This is a fairly heavy lid. The lid on this, what do we call this thing? Standing desk is 26 by 14 1/2. It's 1/2 inch MDF, banded with cherry all the way around and then veneered top and bottom. So it's fairly heavy. And on that one, I used a 1/2 inch dowel as well. Now on furniture, I've gone in and I've used 3/4, which is a little more appropriate. Would you be quiet out here, please? Thank you. So a little bit of it is the actual physical requirements put on the hinge based on weight, but probably more important is the overall look, the aesthetics. What's going to look too big? What might look too small? I probably wouldn't use a 1/4 inch hinge on a lid that big.
Not because it couldn't handle it.
Nah, it could still handle it, but it just...
It would look out of place.
Yeah, look a little too weak maybe. All right, before we take another question, I want to Santa Claus, and if you've been paying attention to our videos, you know who Santa Claus is. Tonight he is giving away. So this venture that we have costs a lot of money. As I mentioned, we cover airfare, hotel, meals, and we send these guys home with enough tools that they can actually build furniture with just hand tools. Plus, we provide the vise that goes on the bench that the bench brigade builds. So to help finance, actually to give you the opportunity to be a part of this and to feel good about it, we accept donations. We do it through our site so that we don't end up paying a bunch of fees to other third parties. So you can, the link will be on there and you can donate and be a part of it. For every $1,000 increment, we are giving away tonight what we call, what do we call it, Jake?
The Ultimate Wood Hinge Bundle.
The Ultimate Wood Hinge Bundle. So let me show you what's in it. The video on making the wood hinge. The, where'd it go? The kit, right here. So this kit, and we have it in Imperial and in metric. So if you're, if you win and you're overseas, we'll send, we'll substitute and send you the metric one if you want. That will allow you to do wood hinges in 3/4 stock, 1/2 inch, 3/8, or quarter. I kind of briefly introduced it at the beginning. We're all, it also includes, now, as I said, a big shout out to Whiteside. These guys make very precise bits. They're out of North Carolina, I think. Yes. Claremont, North Carolina. So it comes with a 1/4 inch bit. This is diameter. The 3/8, the 1/2, and the 3/4 diameter. It also comes with two packages of drill stock. One's 1/2 inch and one is 3/8.
No.
I'm sorry, one is 1/16 inch and one is 1/8 inch.
It's actually only one bundle and it has both of it in it.
All right, then. It has one bundle and it has some of both. And that is the kit. Is, what's the retail on it?
215.
All right. So we'll draw for one of these for every $1,000 increment we get tonight in donations. And I'll take a few more questions, then I'm going to go back and I'm going to tell you some more prizes we got. We got lots of stuff tonight. Go ahead, Frank.
All right.
This next question.
By the way, how big is our audience tonight?
We have currently
766.
Oh, it just went up to 780. I have 780. So very good. We have that part hooked up.
Read me the question, and you can figure it out, because you're going to get Megan that microphone, so she can...
Yep. Yeah. All right, so this comes from Don Erickson in Burlington, Washington.
Hi, Don.
He says, what can be done to stop the lid from cupping over time?
Well, these are really good questions. I'm glad some whoever had the idea to do this came up with it. Oh, boy, I'd have to be really smart in order to answer this one. Good thing I got you here, Ken.
Yeah.
Well, the first answer is you can make your lid like this. This is a little different style. I used to do a lot of boxes like this, not so much anymore, whereas I cut the box itself in half, and the lid is part is sitting in this frame, so you're never going to have a problem with this one. But it's not the look that I want now, so I do it up a little differently. I tend to stay with narrow stock. The narrower the lids, the less chance they're going to cup. However, well, there's a lot to unravel here. If I was going to make my lid out of a piece of cherry, and this is this cherry I was working with, and my lid was going to be a 1/2 inch thick, I would go in on this piece of cherry, and I would remove equal amounts of material on both sides, and I would use the center 1/2 inch. Now, if I was actually taking a 1/2 inch lid, I might make it a little, dimension it down, taking equal amounts off both sides, and then leave it a little bit heavy and let it sit for a while on edge like that and see if it stays put. If it starts to move a lot, probably not a good piece to use. So first of all, I would do what I can to get a stable piece of wood. Second, if you're really concerned about it, you can go with quarter sawn lumber. So when you look at the edge, instead of seeing big rings, if you look at this one, which I chose, you see how the rings are almost perpendicular to the face?
No, I don't see.
Oh, you don't see?
No.
Can you now? So this was box was built. I usually date them. Yeah. Except for this one. But I know because I brought, I said I damaged this one. So this built was built in late 1980s, and that lid has remained remarkably flat. If I sight down there, there's no cupping at all. So it's quarter sawn lumber. However, it's rather bland. The other option you have is to make a lid that has a stable core. So on this box, which is a little bit of a lap desk, I knew I was going to, if you were going to try to make a solid lid that size, you're just asking for problems. The first thing that's going to occur is this. Now, you can't really tell. Actually, this has changed already. But this is a solid wood top. And seasonally, you can probably see how much? At least a 32nd. I don't think it would shrink a 16th, but a 32nd of an inch gap here and here as this shrinks and swells seasonally. So if you were to try to do a lid and you wanted it to be flush here, that would shrink enough that it would really look awkward. So what I did, I took a piece of, must have been, I don't want to guess.
Must have been quarter inch.
Yeah, quarter inch MDF. MDF stands for medium density fiberboard. It's a very stable product. And I glued white oak all along both, all four edges. In fact, you can see it right here. You can see the end grain. So the first thing I did is I glued two strips of solid oak on here, and then I glued a strip along here and along here. Then I veneered it. This is English brown oak veneer. I put veneer on top and bottom. Now, when you're veneering, you have to do that, or else you'll create more stress on one side than the other, and you'll definitely cup it. So veneer top and bottom. And that has stayed nice and flat all these years. It sits down there perfectly. It's not an issue. Same thing was done here with this lid. Again, if this was a solid piece of wood, you're just asking for trouble. There's no way that's going to stay flat, or the chances are very slim. Piece of half-inch MDF, banded on all four sides, veneered top and bottom. How wide would I dare go? A solid piece without doing anything the ordinary? I've got one here. Let me show you this example. Is there anybody tall here?
Where's Rexy?
Oh. I really enjoy making these boxes, by the way. I think this is the widest one that I have made.
Is that much wider than this one?
Oh, no, you're right, Jake. But this is not quarter sawn. So this lid is 6 7/8, and this one is 6 3/8. Now that piece of walnut, if you look at the rings on that, you can see completely different. But I've been pretty lucky because that still lays nice and flat. So if, and just a note on here, I finished it on all surfaces. So there's a finish on the inside, there's a finish on the outside. You're not going to stop a piece of wood from absorbing moisture. But by having a finish on there, you're going to slow that rate. So hopefully that works to help keep things nice and flat. So there, told you all I know. Now, before we take the next question, I want to show you something else. My friend Moose, who we play hockey with, Moose has a business in St. John, and he is donating some of his very unique... Oh, yes. Okay, thank you. They put a cheat sheet back there so I'd see it. I feel like that other guy is always reading off a teleprompter. So we have two more things that we're going to give away tonight. This is turned out to be very popular last time we showed it. This is a hoodie, and it said Mariner's Rule. Now, by the way, we live in St. John, New Brunswick. That's where we're broadcasting from. And St. John was a winter port, which means that our tides are so high, sometimes as much as 30 to 50 feet, depending on where you are in the Bay of Fundy, that the harbor never doesn't freeze in the winter. And back when the St. Lawrence would freeze up, all the ship traffic would be diverted to either Halifax or St. John. So we were a busy port, and shipbuilding was a big thing here as well. So a lot of mariner-related stuff. So this says, the captain is always right, and on the side it says, and I'm the captain. Now, for the wife of the guy who gets this, Megan's going to show the other shirt that's turned out to be very popular.
I just put the website up, by the way.
The t-shirt, yes, the t-shirt. We're going to talk about that one too. So this one says, naughty girl. So, what's it saying about St. John, New Brunswick? Which, by the way, that is his one of his most popular T-shirts. So if you know someone who would really like to have a naughty girl T-shirt, what?
Frick, guys.
Now.
Yeah, I do.
So we're going to give away three things tonight. We're going to give away, we're going to draw for this. I'm the captain. We're going to draw for the naughty girl shirt, and it's in two colors. And we're also going to, do you want to show them your cat sweater? So this fleece, what is it? What's it? It's fleece, right? So this is, you got them backwards.
Oh, come on.
This, so when Moose told me about this, I said, well, Moose, what do you have that people really like? He said, when I carry this, he says, like, it's like holding a cat. And he said, little kids will walk by the, Moose's business is set up in the oldest city, the oldest farmer's market in Canada. It's a really old building. It was built like an upside-down ship. And he said, when little kids will walk by and they'll be hanging there, he says, they go over and they'll hug them because that's what they feel like. But it's really warm.
It's so soft.
And so soft. So if you're unlucky and you don't win tonight, you can always go to Moose's site, which, Frick, you going to put the link up?
It's already there.
It's already there. And you can show St. John some love. Next question. Can we have any live ones?
I'll get Luther. Luther's going to pick those up for me.
Oh, you're waiting for him to do that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Go ahead.
A second here.
Pick my brain.
Okay. This next one. There's a lot of questions about the dowel cutting jig, but you're making a YouTube about that soon,
yeah,
right? Okay.
Yeah. But I'll show it. Do you have one question in particular?
Well, there's one that says, can you show how you made the dowel cutting jig? Another one says, we'd like to see some details on constructing the dowel jig.
Well, I'll show you some examples. That one.
Why are you doing that? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
No.
That one.
Nope.
And Jake, do you know where my one is in lignin that I had set up that I was using?
Somewhere. You can hear me.
Huh?
Okay, why you're doing that? I was just going to shout out the vets that are on so far.
Well, you know, you remind them of what we asked them to do.
Well, we ask you to say your name and what class you were in the chat if I haven't been able to pick you out. I usually recognize the more familiar names to me, but we do get busy in doing other things, so I might have missed a few. So we have Sean McDermott.
Hey, Sean. I was talking to Sean today. Sean just got out of the hospital. He had to go in for some spare parts. He had an appendix rupture. Went in a lot of pain, and that's when they found out. And he had gone septic, and he was in there for quite a while, and he's on the mend. So we're happy to hear it. Sean's a good friend.
Ray. Cool Ray.
Cool. What are you pointing to, friend Ken? Talk to non-live audience. Oh, that's what that says. Cool Ray from Louisiana.
Yep.
Ray, let us know if you're all right after all these. I need to mention this. So we have another vet from Louisiana, Zach Thibodeau. And Zach was in our, do you remember what class Zach was in, Jake?
No.
No. Zach was in a class a couple years ago. And there was two hurricanes that just blew through Louisiana, and he got clobbered both times and destroyed their home. So he and his wife said, that's it. Two in a month is all we can handle. They're on their way, and wish them luck. They're moving to North Carolina. So, and I hope it's not on the shore of North Carolina, because they get clobbered with hurricanes all the time, too. So, Ray, let me know you're all right.
Several people have said that they want to see Frick in that T-shirt.
Naughty girl?
Yeah. It's just, the one I'm wearing is just his size, too. We could...
Well, we could
if we get enough, that. If we get enough donations, I will put on the shirt.
How much? 500?
Is there booty shorts to go with it?
All right.
Keep this Devin G. Wright.
Who else?
Devin Wright.
Hey, Devin. I just spoke to Devin the other day. Good to have you on there. Thank you, Devin.
Paul, of course.
Paul down in our
yeah,
Paul
he's
down
got his
in Australia.
Date to come home. So
he what?
He's got his date to come home.
Oh really? Let us know. Let us know. We'll put you to work.
But don't come
hey,
visit.
And we want to know if you got your boat yet too.
Charlie.
Charlie Ray. Salt of the earth. Thanks for being on, Charlie.
Danny.
Danny Bell.
Danny Bell is on.
The Danny Bell.
Yeah, check out the table.
Don't forget. Oh yeah. So you need to check. So Danny Bell is soon to be retired. Danny is a Chinook helicopter pilot, and Danny has opened a wood business down in Clarksville, Tennessee. So he sells wood that's locally cut. He's also going to be teaching woodworking classes, and he's going to be one of our satellite Purple Heart information gathering, whatever you want to call it. And without COVID being around, we go down there and we actually do a presentation for the vets in the local area. And Danny just did this massive table, this river table. It's huge. Where can they see it?
On Instagram or Facebook.
Okay, how do they find it? Can they put the link in there, Frick?
Hardwood Grove.
Hardwood yep. Grove. You got to check it out. You got to see it. It's awesome.
Jake is on.
Jake Tirola?
Yeah.
Jake, brother? Jake, the other Jake just found out you were a goalie. Doesn't pay attention.
Gary.
Gary Bennett?
Burnett,
sorry. Gary. Gary's always with us. Great to have you, Gary.
And Gary bought his wife a cat sweater.
Oh,
too,
oh yeah, that's yeah. Man, Moose told me about that.
And Ebby's on.
Tell him, make sure you tell us another thing how well she liked it. Ebby's on. Where did Ebby move to?
Atlanta.
Well,
Georgia, I don't know. If it's
he's supposed to be getting his shop put together, so that's great. Glad you had a good move. Happy to have you on here.
Rob White.
Oh, Rob White, yeah. Hey, Rob, glad you made it.
And
I'm only laughing because last night I so desperately wanted to contact as many vets as possible to tell them about tonight so they could be on to see Herman. And I was going down through my phone, and I came to Rob Brown. And I was thinking Rob White. So I called Rob Brown up, and I was rattling off all this stuff. And I hung up, and I kind of thought, gee, he sounded a little different. I got down through the rest of my phone, I got to Rob White, and I said, oh, no. That's not Rob Brown. It's Rob White, not Rob Brown. So Rob Brown is another guy who thinks I'm crazy.
He's colorblind,
crazy.
So.
Yeah, you get your
all right. Browns and whites mixed up.
Hold that right there.
Pete.
Hold that. Hold that.
Pete's
oh, Pete.
The last one.
Pete Ambrose.
All colors are the same.
Pete, our prayers are out there for your son. Keep us posted. And please, Frick, give me another question.
All right, here we go. This one comes from Michelle. He's local. He's from Oramucto.
West. Oh, wow.
About a half an hour from here.
It's and almost he, as local as it gets.
Yeah, really.
We can throw a rock that far.
And he says, can any species of wood be utilized for wood boxes, or are there specific kinds that can or can't be used?
Good question. Very good question. So if you'll notice, almost all of my boxes, actually, that's not true, but normally, if I were to look at the 1,000 boxes that I've done, I would tell you that 950 of them have either a bird's eye maple or some kind of figured maple top. And here's the reason why. And just before I finish answering this, if you are a combat wounded vet that has been to one of our workshops, would you please let Megan know in the comment section, tell us what class you were in so we can give you a shout out. Always love to acknowledge your presence, and always also like to acknowledge what you have done for your country as well. So here's the reasoning. I like to use exotics. I like it because it gives you a nice a contrast. So this black piece or dark piece is a piece of Macassar ebony. I'll give you some other examples. This is a piece of Gaboon ebony. This is a piece of Catalox, also known as Mexican rosewood. This is a piece of Brazilian tulip wood. This is a piece of Australian lace wood. Paul will come home with a bunch of that. This is a piece of Bastogne walnut. The exotics tend not to glue very well. And if you tried making a dowel out of a piece of tulip wood, it would be rather tough. I like to have this continuous, the side, the back, the top, and the front, and the dowel all made out of the same wood. That way you're insured a good, strong glue joint that will last a very long time. Maple is a very, very tough wood, but it machines well, it glues well, so that's the and it's light in color, so it contrasts well with most of your exotic woods. So I would say you can use any wood for your box, but you want to keep your lid and your dowel and your back, if you want to have that dowel somewhat disappear, to be the same species. And I find maple to be the best with that. Now, here's an example. Let me tell you all my mistakes. So I used a piece of walnut burl in this. The problem with walnut burl is that it does not have specific grain direction. So when it expands this way, it expands this way, which doesn't bode well. There are times of the year when you cannot open the lid because it had expanded so much, it just locks it. So not a great choice for that reason. There's a piece of cherry. Now, cherry, like maple, is going to machine well, glue well, so that's not going to be an issue. It's just that you don't get cherry figured as readily as you get maple. Maple, you get it in fiddleback, you get it in quilted, you get it in bird's eye, relatively plentiful, at least around here. This, I already explained that one, what that one was. This is walnut, same idea, or same principle. Easy wood to work, but I guess what I should say is if you were to get a nice piece of really figured walnut, it tends to be a little less stable. What I find with the bird's eye figure in particular is it's as stable as any wood, even though it's got all that figure in it. So use any wood you want. Just bear that in mind that you've got to make your hinge, and you don't want to be trying to make a hinge. I've made wood hinges out of ebony, and they're difficult to turn because they're so hard, and they don't glue extremely well. So you've got to take all of that into consideration when you're making these. Next, Frick, have we got a live one?
Nope.
No?
Luther's taking care of those.
Oh, is he? All right. Then give me another one.
All right. This comes from Marcus McRae in Texas. He says, other than your drawer bottom plane, is there a hand tool method or another hand plane that you'd recommend for cutting the grooves for the bottom of the wood hinge box?
I'm going to ask you to read that again, please. I was thinking he was going somewhere else with that.
For the bottom of the box, like for your drawer.
Groove that you're going to cut. Okay. There's something that's in my head that I'm trying to get out. What other stuff were we giving away tonight? We were giving away the t-shirts. We're giving away the wood hinge kits. Was there anything else? Oh, Harold, you want to go get the twirly whirly? Yeah, I knew I had to remember that. He's supposed to be here. So how are you going to cut the lid, the groove in the bottom? Yeah. So let me show you, because I did it. I was hoping to have a box. Actually, I have a box in pieces that I can show you. So here's the groove. Now, what I would do with this piece, I kept this, if you have this, we just released a YouTube video the other day. It shows how I do this. It's a lot easier to work with a big piece of wood than it is a little thin piece. So I cut all everything on this, and the last thing I do is rip a strip off of here and strip off of there, and it becomes the front and back. So his question is, how am I going to cut that groove that will house the bottom? I actually have one here that I just was working on today. So that's got an 1/8-inch plywood bottom that has to fit in that groove all the way around. But if you allowed the groove, if you ran, this is the part that's tough, if you ran the groove all the way through, when you put your joint together, you'd have a square hole right there. Now, what I do, or when I'm setting up for it, follow me down here, Jake, please. We may as well actually show this. You've got to cut a groove in all four pieces. Now, this is assuming that you don't want... I don't like to attach... Here's our 1/8-inch plywood. I don't want to attach that to the bottom of my box and glue it to the bottom, and then you're seeing the edge. I would much rather have that neatly tucked into a groove like that, which I think just elevates your overall...
Wait, you're at a range.
For what?
Your microphone.
Hold on a second. Okay, walk down here so they can hear me. Tell me when I'm back in.
Yeah, you are.
I thought that microphone was good anywhere in this shop.
Well, there's just so much stuff in the way right now.
Okay. You have to cut a groove on all four pieces. So I have the opportunity of setting it up so that the groove runs in between the pins. So these are called the pins. These are called the tails. Because I can run the groove between the pins, this one and this one, this is a real easy piece to do. And you could do that with, you could do this with any hand tool or hand plane that cuts a narrow groove like that. The problem in trying to cut this groove with a plow plane or anything like that is you have to stop it here and stop it there, and you just, you can't do it. What you could do, and it's a pile of work because I've done it before, is you could go in here, and the way I would do it is I would take a marking gauge and I would outline the outside edge. This is just a piece of pine, so we'll do it. I would outline, let's actually move it up in here so we can see it. I would outline the outside edge of the groove, and I would cut it nice and deep as I could get that cutter to go. Then I would take another marking gauge, or that one, and I would turn the cutter around. And I would set that in there, and you got to be really careful with this because when you pull the marking, you're just going to want to wander off on you. But if you're careful, you can go in, and if you don't turn it around, the bevel's going to be on the wrong side, and that won't show very well. Oh, see, that's already wandering on me. You got to really apply a lot of force because the shape of the cutter makes it want to go this way. Now, at least you've got your outside edges. Next thing I would do is I would come in with an IBC 1/8 inch chisel, a little plug, and I would cut this, or I would end the groove, and I would take it down to depth, and I would do that on both ends. Take it all the way down to depth. Then with a router plane, if you switch the cutters, this is a Lee Nielsen small router plane. It's called a number 271. And it comes with a little narrow cutter.
I don't think it does anymore.
What? You think you got to buy them separately?
I'm pretty sure it's separate.
So there's your small narrow cutter. You would put that in there. And the worst part about this is it tends to beat your pieces up because you have to make so many multiple passes. Now you've got to come in, and keeping that centered, you'd have to run that forth and back until you get that entire groove cut so it's the same depth as this one. And as I said, because you're making so many passes back and forth, you tend to beat this piece up a fair bit. It is possible, but it is difficult. The easiest way to do it, I have discovered, is with an 1/8 inch router bit where you can simply drop the piece down on the cutter, move it over and lift it off, flip it over and do the other side. That is by far the easiest way to do it. If you don't mind seeing a square hole, you could always go in and plug that piece of hole, but that just doesn't seem to look right, I don't think. Okay, actually, let me show you one more example. We had a group of vets here from Base Gagetown a couple weeks ago, and we showed them how to make a little wooden box like this, starting entirely with hand tools, no power tools whatsoever. So what I did in this case is I made what's called a stepped dovetail. That means that I could use my drawer bottom plane. You got to follow me, Jake. So here's
I'm a little dumb.
Hey, just make sure that we don't bump into that.
Can we just recognize somebody really quick?
Yeah, who?
One of our viewers. His name is Robert Steele. I think we should give him credit. He just made a donation of $8,000.
Are you serious?
And not only that, we were looking at his previous donations. He's actually donated $15,500 since May.
So what's his name?
Robert Steele. I don't think we've given him the credit that he deserves. So,
well, I need to call him. So would you get his phone number, please, so that I can call him personally?
Right now? well, maybe he doesn't.
I wouldn't want to. No, that might not be
cool. But I'll certainly call him myself afterwards. And if he's okay with it, I'd certainly bring him on. Robert, that was, yeah, you already know. You do this for the right reason. You know how you're blessed, and you know what you're doing for the lives of these other gentlemen. So good on you. So here's my drawer bottom plane. You guys keep doing stuff like that, you throw me off. It's the drawer bottom plane. In order for this to work, it has to be allowed to go all the way through. You can't start and stop with it because you have this part of the sole ahead of the blade and you got this part behind it. Well, you can't, you know, this is going to run into the part that you're trying to stop. You can use it to cut your groove all the way through. So in other words, when I did this box, I cut a groove all the way through on this piece, this piece, this piece, and this piece. On the end ones, as I showed you, they went between the pins, so that wasn't a problem. So what I did on this one, I employed what's called a stepped dovetail. So I changed, there's the thickness of the piece, but out here in the end, I cut that in half on both ends, and that hid my groove because this part of the pin board went all the way up to here. It stopped here on this one, but it went all the way up to here on that one. So that is called a step dovetail. And if we haven't done that before, that's probably a good topic for a future dovetail YouTube video, and it'll explain you how to do it. Explain you?
It'll explain you.
That's, I hang around Luther so much, I'm starting to talk to him. I need to go to this. What's the name of that Tallahassee place where he went to school?
Clemson.
You do. There's too many people, fans of Clemson there. Next question. Any more vets to speak of, to shout out to?
Derek is on.
Hey, Derek. I want to see the bench when you guys are done. Derek and Charlie are working on some benches.
And
Philip Gustafson. I always have to do this. I got to tell you a little bit about something about Philip Gustafson. He made me cry today when I was... trying to tell his story to someone later in the day. Because Philip is probably one of the best examples of how this program, and it's not us, we just kind of, you know, throw it all together and try to make it work. But Philip is a great example of what this woodworking and this community and you people, how you can impact the lives of these combat wounded vets. So Philip came to our very first class, and I'm going to set you up and tell you the story because I think it's a little bit funny. So I just a quick background so that you understand. My wife and I have 10 children, 6 girls, 4 boys, and I discovered after 11 years of trying to earn a living building furniture that you can't feed a family of that size. We only had half that many at the time building furniture. I was born 100 years too late. So in 2000, I made the transition to selling tools, which led into teaching. I have taught thousands of people how to cut dovetails. I started my first dovetail class in 1987, and there's been times when I would teach a class at least once, if not 2 or 3 times a week. And I know how long the average person takes to get to the point where they can do it properly. And in the class, you have to, on your cutting your tailboard, you have to make 6 perfect cuts. That's 3 tails. 1 cut on each side, and when I say perfect, meaning when you check them across the end, they have to be square. The joint won't work otherwise. And the average guy taking the class probably has 10 to 14 attempts at cutting a tailboard before he finally gets one where all 6 cuts are right. So we're teaching the class, brand new. 15 minutes into it, Philip says, Rob, I'm done. And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, whatever. So I mosey on down there, and I look, and I'm thinking, holy crap, he actually did it. So what am I going to do with this guy for the next 3 hours while everybody else is trying to learn? So fortunately, he screwed up big time because he went to cut the other half of the joint, and he cut the wrong parts off. So on his second attempt, his first attempt was perfect, he did what I would consider to be probably the best first-time dovetail that I've ever seen. That's it right there, his name on there, Philip Gustafson, and absolutely fantastic. He's a very generous man. He contributes on a monthly basis to the Purple Heart Project, wanting to give back. I try to explain to other people that the military mentality is you lay your life on the line for your brother, and that never goes away. So they're always concerned about how to help their fellow brothers and sisters in the military. So, Philip, wonderful to have you. Next, you got a question for me, or we got another shout out?
Robert said that his donation was for his father, his stepfather, his son?
My dad, my stepdad, my grandfather, my nephew, and son-in-law.
Wow. Amazing. So
thank you again.
Salute them for me and thank them for us. I was just reading on Facebook the other day, Super Dave's mom, Super Dave Benson, by the way, always, I usually start off a little bit differently, and I do...
Artist,
she is wonderful. So I always have to mention a few people. Where's Angie?
Right behind the flag.
No, that's Saddam. Oh my goodness, where's my picture of Angie?
It could be behind the plaque.
Yep. Good call, Jake. I hope that didn't hurt Angie.
She's watching.
Having that plaque sitting on you. So this is Angie. This is Ken's cousin, and Angie and her sister Lynn take care of the t-shirts. Oh, by the way, should we show them?
No,
don't show them.
I can't go all the way.
What?
Up. Yeah.
Oh, well, Angie and Lynn, we just got in how many boxes?
Nine
boxes of t-shirts. So I hope you didn't have anything planned for the next 6 months. So what Angie does is they fold the t-shirts up. These are our Purple Heart t-shirts. Fold them all up and package them so neatly. Angie puts a sticker on there with her little A on there for her seal of approval. So she's an integral part of our team. This is Super Dave. Now, if I said which of these two were the most handsome, you'd say, well, turn it over this way. Oh, yes, that's better. Super Dave is right here in the dark. They look so much alike. And Super Dave came to one of our classes as a combat wounded vet. We had him tell the story because it's humorous too, but I won't bore you with the details. Anyway, he's now part of our team.
We've got a recent picture of Super Dave that we're going to put up in just a moment.
Yeah. So Super Dave takes care of all the applications. By the way, if you know of anyone, any vet, who is injured in combat, whether it's a physical wound or a mental wound, that's our stipulation to be a part of our program. It has to be combat related. Have them contact us. In the application process, Luther takes care of the first 3 months of each year, May, June, July, and Super Dave takes care of the last 3 months, September, October, November, pardon me, August, September, October. And his mom up in Alaska just wrote down a long military history in his family, and it goes way back to his great-great or great-grandfather who fought in World War II. Or World War One.
I think great grandfather.
Great grandfather, World War One. Grandfather, World War Two. Father was either Korea or Vietnam. Yeah. Vietnam. And Super Dave was in Afghanistan.
His great grandfather, did you say that?
His great grandfather, yeah. Yeah. So awesome service. Okay.
I'm showing that handsome picture of Super Dave right now on the screen.
Oh, yeah, I saw that. That was the picture.
Yeah. It's
so up. If you're ever in that part of near Fort Drum, and you're looking for great eggs, at the end of his driveway, he has a little box where you can pick up fresh eggs, and you just pay right there. I'm wanting to do that.
Chris Cosman was on, but he's not techy enough to say hello.
Oh, Chris, yeah. Hey, Chris.
Can I get to my questions now?
Yep.
Jeez, please. Luther's gonna kill you. And me.
Luther's
all right.
Not allowed in the country.
So I got four quick questions, really quick. So you got to get through them quickly. These are all from the chat, actually. First one's from Dan Boyette.
Hi, Dan.
He says, what kind of finish do you put on those boxes?
Ken, would you grab me a can of Deft, please? I'll answer that shortly.
Norman Olson says, have you ever flocked a box interior? What is your opinion of flocking in general?
Well, flocking is probably the cheapest way to dress up the interior. So flocking is essentially dust, and you put a spray glue or some kind of an adhesive on the bottom, And then a flocker is, it's like this tube that you ram a piston through the end and it spurts out air, and you put the flocking in there. It's like colored dust, and it goes on there and it sticks. No, I hate it. It's not durable. It just is not durable. I mean, it's one of those things that looks okay as long as you don't touch it. But no, I wouldn't consider that to be a good option for the interior of a box, especially if they're going to get used at all. Now, so this is what I use. I don't have any connection to them, but I would do commercials for them. This is Deft lacquer, and probably one of the best things about it is the tip. So that little red part on the tip, you can turn it 90 degrees, and your fan will go from being like this to being that way. And it'll lay a, oh my goodness, it's so nice. Didn't we do a video on this?
On spraying,
but we did it on that spray can, yeah.
Using that.
So go and look in the link down below. They'll put a link to the YouTube we did on this on how to do it. But it is the absolute best finish for these small boxes. The spray's not powerful enough to knock the box over, which is what happens when I use my big spray gun. It'll just lay on there. Even if you've never done it before, you can get the hang of it. All you think you want to do is don't spray like this. When you spray, you move your wrist like that so that the spray is hitting the surface perpendicular to it over the entire motion. If you go like this, what's going to happen is you're going to have very light coverage here, heavy coverage in the middle, light coverage out there. So you need to move along like that as you're doing the spraying. And I always start spraying, move across the piece, continue to spray until you get past it, then let up. And then when you start over here, you start spraying and move into it so that you don't want to try to start, push down and start at the same spot, because what you end up doing is you end up putting too much material in that one spot. So I'm already spraying. I would then move across my piece and stop once I'm beyond. Takes a little while, but it's the only downside to this stuff, it does not have any water resistance. It's lousy that way. But these boxes typically are not used in the bathroom. And you can get it in semi-gloss, gloss. And someone told me the other day that you can get satin or something even less than that, which I would do. I really like the low sheen. And three coats is probably enough. You can spray this, turn around three times. It'll be dry. Spray it again, turn around three times, spray it again. And you know what? Here's one of the secrets. Now, this might be from what I do. I have rough hands. But I'll take this after first coat, and it's dry, and I'll go in there and I'll just rub it with my hand like that, and that usually does anything you would get from fine sandpaper with all the dust, without the dust, and that'll knock off any little nibs, and you put the next coat on there and do the same thing, and the final coat, usually you don't have to do anything, and it comes out perfect. Now, yes?
Rick probably couldn't do that with his hands, though. His would be like 1,000 grits in.
So he takes so much abuse. Now, what I'm going to tell you, I'm going to use this as an opportunity to tell you something that's advantageous for you and for us. If you spray a hand plane surface, contrary to spraying a sanded surface, if you look at a sanded surface, even if you go up to 600 grit, under magnification, you're going to see these fine little hairs that are a result of that abrasive particle on the paper scratching the wood. And sometimes when you put a finish on it, those little hairs get frozen in time and they're sticking up like this, and that's what makes it feel so rough. But a hand plane surface, look at that under magnification, and you've got this beautiful clean surface that has been severed by a knife in a plane that has been sharpened up to, in our case, 16,000 grit. And it is so much better. And sometimes you don't have to do anything between coats. Now, what I wanted to tell you about is this. If you look at the old Stanley planes, it's a great example. That's called the adjuster knob. And that adjuster knob was so small diameter, it was a bear to be able to spin that thing to try to adjust your blade. You have to have enough tension on this thing called the lever cap to hold that blade in a fixed position so it doesn't move about when you're using it. but that also makes it very difficult to adjust that. And as you get older and you get a bit of arthritis in your hands, that's an absolute pain. So about a year ago, we started working on this idea, and this is called the Adjust Star, A-D-J-U, capital S-T-A-R. And that replaces that wheel, and when that goes on your plane, now you can just push down on one of those spokes. It is so much easier to do. We introduced this about a month ago. Our inventory lasted 12 hours and we were out. We got back, we got restocked at the beginning of this week, so we have them in there. These will fit all Wood River planes except for the number 3 and the number 4. There's not enough room. We made this quite wide. Obviously, the longer that spoke is, the more leverage you have. We also have a version that fits the Lee Nelsons, but they're not ready yet. They may be another week, week and a half. Stay tuned. But the ones for your Wood River, your 5.5, are now available, and we've been shipping them for the last 4 or 5 days. That was question 2. What's number 3, Frick?
Yeah, so much for quick.
Or did I skip 2 and go right to 3 and have to be reminded that I'm on 2?
You were on 2. Next one comes from Airford 13. This is his username.
Who?
Airford 13, that's just his YouTube username. Would you ever make boxes out of softwoods?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, probably have an example. I've got just about everything else. Well, that box right there is made out of pine, the one I was working on with the vets. Some of these are made out of pine. You're talking about wood hinge. I have done a couple of boxes. Angie's desk is made out of, well, it's kind of a box.
I think he's asking.
Yeah, the wood hinge. I have made some, however, the wood is really soft. It's not ideal. In fact, if you want to make a pine box, I would suggest that you make the dowel out of maple. The pine is just, it just does not have the strength in those small pieces. And when you flush off the back of that dowel, like I was showing you, you just don't have much material there, and it won't take a lot of stress. So now you, YEW, Ken, do we have a piece of that kicking around? Which is a soft wood, a coniferous, beautiful wood. I wouldn't have any problem. In fact, I think I'll make one now that you mention it. So if your question were to mean soft as in very, not very hard woods, how do you say that without making sense? I would tend to avoid those because the hinge needs to be somewhat robust. Next, Frick.
Okay, next one is from, also from the chat, comes from Woodwork Learner, that's his username. Can you make a wooden hinge using only hand tools?
Oh yeah, when he asked about the groove, that's what I was thinking. Technically, you should be able to. I've thought about it numerous times because this question comes up a lot. You have to shape your cutter. So you got to remember, for every router bit that you own today, 100 years ago, your counterpart had a molding plane that had that same profile.
I think they're all down back.
Where are they? Oh, they're all down there. So, here's a good example. Here's one of my wooden planes. I have one here, Jake, don't I, with the... the bead. So if this cutter was a radius, but the problem is that you have to do the math on it, because if the cutter was laying this way, perpendicular to the way you push it, you could make a perfect half round like a scraper and it would work. But the minute you start to pull it back like that, in order to get a half round, you have to change the shape of your cutter in order for it to maintain an actual half round. I haven't done that yet. I don't think it would be terribly difficult, but it would involve some math, which automatically would throw me into a fit. But yes, you can do it. I haven't done it. I may do it at some point. If you do it before me, I would love to see your results.
But it's not, I mean, you're only using a small router for that.
Oh, yeah. This, it doesn't take much. I've got a little, I'm using a Bosch Colt, which usually you can pick up for about $100. That's the router I've got in there. And I just leave it parked in there so I don't have to set it up every time. Rick?
All right, this one comes from Duke Engine. He says, could you give us an idea of how tight the hinge should be on the two ends when you got it into the box?
Yes. Yes. Yep. So what he's referring to, or what he means is, when I take that hinge that I've assembled, and I've laid it out so that it's I have the number of pieces that I want it to fit in between here and here. So when I do that, what I do is I will have cut all my pieces, put the little pins in, put it all back together. Do I have one? I thought I had one down there. And then I hold it like this on that end, and then on this end, and you got to be careful when you're doing this. I can hear people gasping now. Holding it like that, I lay my chisel on the inside edge, nice and flat, and I just make a little mark right there in the dowel. And then usually with my magnifiers on, I go over to my, I made a special little bench hook. This bench hook has, I'll talk to you about this too, because it's all part and parcel. I just got to find some room here, so let me move a few things out of my way. Ever since I stopped selling these boxes, they're accumulating. Start selling them again. Because I love making them, but... So, a bit of a pause. I made this jig because I wanted to be able to reduce the amount of interruption in the grain on the dowel. So I've made my dowel. The first thing I would do in preparing to do this is I would come in here and with a pen that doesn't work.
Specifically a pen that doesn't work.
Yeah, because every one I ever grab usually doesn't work. I'll use a pencil, but it's harder for you to see. Mm-hmm. You go in and you draw a line on your dowel. Now what I've got to go in there and I've got to make multiple cuts. Well, if you do it at a table saw, you're using upwards of an eighth of an inch of material, and that's going to interrupt any of your grain. And I want that grain to look uninterrupted so that nobody can even see the joint lines until the hinge gets opened. So my crosscut saw has a kerf that's just 24 thousandths of an inch thick. 24 thousandths is 6 sheets of paper, okay? Very, very narrow set. So instead of using this on the table saw, I made this bench hook. So what I did is I took this piece of wood. It was all one piece. I went over to my router table, and I routed half of that groove all the way through. Okay. I then cut this piece, shot it on the shooting board. So when it went back together, it was straight and it was a perfect fit. I glued this piece on. I took my saw. I put my saw at the end. I moved this piece over to it tight, glued it in place. So when I removed it, I had zero clearance with my saw. Now when I go in and I make a cut, I'm only losing 24 thousandths of an inch. That saw cuts so well, it gives you a very nice surface. You don't have to do anything to it. You put the two of them back together, and you end up with the light's just right, you can't see the joint lines on there. So what I do is I get my magnifiers on, and I've got that little tiny chisel mark that I made when I was referencing the length of this dowel to set down in there. And with my magnifiers, I can go in there and I can literally set the outside edge, the tooth. So remember, these teeth are set. Each tooth is bent. If the first one is bent this way, the next one is bent that way. And I'll go in there and I'll set that tooth, those teeth, right on that little knife mark. And I'll go ahead and I'll make my cut. Now, the question was, how tight? Well, when I put that in there, I want it just tight enough that I just have to push it a little bit in order to get it in. If it's loose at all, then the lid falls like that. Now, this is actually loose because, as I mentioned, this wood shrinks in both all directions. But when done ideally, you want the lid to stay put in any position. Just enough friction. By the way, I'd like to do stuff like this too. And remember the question on flocking? I would much rather use leather on the bottom. So what I do is I buy a bunch of leather, thin leather, and I glue it with regular white or yellow glue to the inside of a piece of Baltic birch plywood, and that gives you a real classy look on the inside. And sometimes I actually go in and I do leather on both sides. I'll show you one I made for my wife. Now you're asking me, why is it here? Well, because I made it for her, I just didn't give it to her. So on this one, I decided I would use deer skin.
Show the whole box.
No, so this one is made out of one type of wood, which is some really highly figured maple. And I took so good care of this, and then one time we were doing the show, and it didn't get packed properly, and there's all the marring right there. But on the, what I did is I used deer hide on both the inside and the outside. But what I didn't realize is the nap on that deer hide is so fragile. When I was getting ready to spray this, I had to mask this off with painter's tape, which hardly sticks at all. But it was sticky enough that it pulled the nap off that deer hide. That's why you can see that torn bit. But it's so nice to have something other than what you're expecting when you open up a box like that. Next question, Frick. By the way,
we're over $10,000 in donations.
Wow.
Does that mean I have to put on the Naughty Girl shirt?
If we reach 11,000, Frick has to put on the Naughty Girl shirt.
All right.
Strip down naked from the waist up and then put it on?
No.
People will leave. So, by the way, that is my crosscut saw. Ken, what do you think about these crosscut saws? Do they cut as well as I brag about?
Better.
Yeah. We get more compliments when people use a crosscut saw than they do on our dovetail saw, and they rave about the dovetail saw. So if you plan, I'm going to try to take away from being a shameless commercial here. If you plan on doing this seriously, meaning you want to do a lot of it, the better you can get your joinery, the better you can hide things and disguise it, it just elevates everything. And you want that cut to be as narrow as possible. And I don't think anybody, well, yeah, actually, that's not true. A Japanese saw would have a narrower kerf. I just don't like the way they cut. Now, by the way, the reason why I have that groove there, it acts as a zero clearance. So when I'm making my saw cut through there, I don't get tear on the backside because that groove supports the wood fiber all the way around, or at least on the back half. The front half, you're cutting into it this way, you're not going to have that problem anyway. I've been doing this a long time. You guys are making me think of stuff I haven't thought of in a long time, so this is great. Next.
Okay, this one comes from Kenny Kong in Firecrest, Washington.
Hey, Kenny. Hi, Kenny. Kenny's a good customer because I recognize his name.
Okay, he says, how do you ensure your box is square during glue-up? I found my box is always out of square just a little bit after the glue dries.
Mm.
I had used clamps and no clamps. Same result. Thanks.
Okay. Well, ideally, if your joinery has just the right amount of friction, that means if it's a dovetail, you glue it up, you tap it together, and the joint is just tight enough that the friction alone will hold it. Then you, if it's not square, you can squeeze it opposite corners to get into position, but then you can leave it once square and just let it dry like that. It's when you have to apply clamps that you get into that risky situation where you start to introduce some stress, or you make it difficult to actually measure. So ideally, first and foremost, make your joint such that friction alone holds it together. You don't use clamps. If you have to use clamps, how are you going to do it? Well, when I'm clamping, in fact, I was having to do it on this one. I was in order to pull it tight. When clamping, you try to clamp. You want to pull directly across through here. I don't want to be clamping out here because if I'm off a little bit, that's going to throw it off. But if I'm clamping right down through this piece, and what I'm clamping is I'm trying to close this joint line right here and this joint. So I want to clamp right there, which usually means you got a couple, get a little couple pieces of wood like this, and then run your clamp right there. And that hopefully isn't going to produce any stress in this direction or that direction. It would throw it out of square. You also want to make sure when you put your clamps on that it gives you full access to measure your diagonals side to side. Now let me back up one step. Kenny, I'm sure I've sold you a shooting board at some point, but if you start, when you're making boxes, you have to start right from the very beginning. Everything has to be precise. Don't take pieces off a table saw or a chop saw and expect that to be accurate enough. It's not going to be. I always shoot all of my pieces. You want it so that when you put your box together, you put one corner together, then you put the other corner, then you put the top two corners go at the same time, but you do one first, and when you reach over to do the second one, if you've got to shift a piece of wood either way in order to get it to fit, you know there's going to be something screwed up. You want it so that that's perfectly in position and those things just go down like that and everything is honky-dory. Well, if you've done that and checked and made sure all of your pieces were square, you have a good, accurate shooting board, you have a plane that you're comfortable with, you know how to sharpen, and you still have problems, then you got to try to trace back and say, okay, where did I go wrong? You have to make sure that this piece and this piece are the exact same length. You've got to make sure that this piece and this piece are the exact same length. You got to make sure that your depth at the bottom of your tails is the same. If you're doing it by hand, that's done with a marking gauge. If you're doing it with a router, you got to make sure that when you make those passes that you don't allow anything to shift. All those things have to be done right. The last thing I'd say is it's always best to make up some kind of a jig so that you're clamping directly across from the joint. Make sure that when you put your clamps on, you're leaving it open so that you can come in and adjust. And also consider that if you need to pull it, have some kind of a method where you can get a hold of it corner to corner with your clamp and just pull it into position to hopefully get it squared up, and then the glue will dry that way. Now, the last thing I'll tell you about that is this. If you're using a box joint like this, using one of the jigs that I show you, you're best to use cyanacrylate, because you can put the whole thing together. Once the joints are tight, you go in with cyanacrylate and then just let it wick in and around the parts. It doesn't take long, it'll set up, and you don't have to fuss with applying regular white or yellow glue and having it all over the place. That this is the best secret to making wood hinge boxes. At least the joinery part is using cyanacrylate to glue the pieces. That's how almost all of these are done, and it works miracles. If that doesn't work, call me. Go Frick. Oh, by the way, just a quick reminder. So we'd love to have you help us promote our cause. So we have three t-shirts. Angie picked this color. You'll see our logo, Purple Heart Project, up here. This one says Wood Doing Good on the back. Then we have these two. This was the very first one we started with. Same logo. This is in navy, Wood Is Good. And our latest in khaki green says Wood For Good. So order a t-shirt, keep Angie and Lynn employed, and packing t-shirts, we'll send it out. It's a great way to start a conversation. And why do I say this? If you're watching after the live episode, you can still donate to the Purple Heart Project. Yes.
That didn't look right.
I'm trying to be our buddy there. I'm terrible with a teleprompter. So, you threw me. You pointed that. They've got notes in the background. Why do we do this? Here's our biggest problem, back to the Purple Heart Project, is finding the combat wounded vets who need our help. They tend to isolate themselves. They don't go out in public. And nobody knows, they suffer in silence. It's only people who know them, usually a direct personal contact, that's able to get to them. Wearing these t-shirts and somebody says, what's the Purple Heart Project? The more people that know about it, the better chance we're going to have of finding the people that really need it. The application process is simple. You go to our website, RobCosman.com. On the left-hand side, tells you all about the PHP. Luther has put in tons of information in there. Application is right on there. You can fill it out and apply. And don't hesitate to apply a second, third, or fourth time if you don't get selected the first time. We only have room for a certain number. We try to do it like triage. Bring in the people that need it the most, at least based on what we think. Danny Bell, how many times?
Three
times before Danny was accepted. And this has changed Danny's life for the better. And I can say that because he has told that to me numerous times. And he spends a lot of effort now trying to help other vets. So get yourself a t-shirt.
Now, Mark is on.
Pardon?
Mark is on.
Mark Smith? Our Mark Smith.
Yes.
Brother. Wait till you see upstairs.
And so is Bob.
Come back and visit Bob.
Abbott.
The captain.
Bobbert. Yes, the captain. I was talking to Bob today. So if you're watching this after and you're not on live with us tonight and you would like to help, you can anytime you can go onto our site, RobCosman.com, and you can donate and support the Purple Heart Project. It's all on there. We appreciate your help. You'll see where it goes when you watch the interviews that we do with the vets and you see the kind of good that it does. All of your donation goes to this project. Nobody takes a salary from this. We use the money to provide plane tickets, meals, accommodations, and tools and any associated costs because we bring in a vet from a previous class every time we teach to come in as our assistant, and it gives us a chance to reconnect with them. Okay, question.
Okay, this one comes from R. Dean. And he says, when I make these hinges, I drill each segment all the way through and use a solid rod from end to end. Have you ever tried that?
Well, so you're trying to drill a hole a 16th of an inch in diameter. I don't know if you're using this or not, but I'm talking to everybody else. A 16th inch drill bit is not stiff, and it will wander and want to follow the path of least resistance. So the first thing you're going to encounter is, how do I drill on center? If your drill bit or your drill bit does not stay in the center of that piece of wood, and now when you put your pin in and you line them up and part of it is sticking out over, well, it's not going to work very smoothly, and it may actually break the joint when you do it. So did I even talk about that jig? I think I showed it. Yeah, I did. So that's what that does. However, I would not trust that little drill bit to drill through 3/4 of an inch of dowel and actually come out the other end in the center. And it's not necessary because all you need is about 1/8 of an inch of that rod in each piece. The two pieces of dowel are tight against each other. So the hole that we drilled is 1/16 of an inch in diameter. The rod is 1/16 of an inch in diameter, so there's no wiggle there. And if you're captured 1/8 of an inch on that side and you're captured 1/8 of an inch on that side with the two pieces of dowels pushed together like that, you can't get any movement. So it works perfectly. So there is no reason to drill all the way through. Next.
Okay, this one comes from Daryl Brook in Dawesville, Western Australia. He says, any tips for getting the wood... Any tips for getting the wood hinge groove just right in the lid and back? My test pieces...
Oh, okay. Yes. Oh, good question. Good question. This is not a very pretty jig, but what I learned is you mess around with it so much, when you finally get it where you want it, you just leave it. So here's a couple of things to consider. And you got to make sure, we got to get the terminology down. Diameter and radius. This is 1/4 of an inch in diameter. So half of that would be the radius, which would be 1/8 of an inch. So you're going to have part of your, I'm going to use this, never mind. Just let me make this cut real quick, please. I'll plug it in first. I'm going to cut a groove in the lid so that you can better understand this. Or what would be the lid. Okay, so there's the bottom, or the back, and there's the lid, and they're going to sit on there like that. Now let me just take this piece that I cut the hole in. This is actually a really good question. I'm glad he asked it.
Quick one. What color is that chisel handle? Is that pink ivory?
Which one? Yes. And that is the pinkest pink ivory I have ever seen. That was sent to us by Ahmed. And sometime in the next 10 years, we're actually going to have these really super pretty chisel handles for sale. Ahmed, nudge, nudge, wink. But that is, yeah, I've never seen pink ivory that pink. Unbelievable, huh? Gorgeous stuff. Okay. Here's my dowel. There's the hole in the middle. We set that on there. Now, the first thing you have to realize is that the center of the dowel must be inside of the back of the box. If we moved it over this way, when you started to flush off the back, you would expose the hole, hence you would expose the pin and ruin your joint. So you have to keep that, you have to keep that hole, or the middle of the dowel, inside of the back of the box. And the farther inside it is, the more wood you have on the outside edge, the stronger it's going to be. Okay, so as far as where it positions that way. Now, what you'll notice, and as much as I've done this, I can't really explain it to you why. What I prefer to get is I want the lid to stop before you open a gap here. I'll show you what I mean. That one. Do you see how you can see down through here? I don't like that. I just kind of look sloppy for some reason. I don't like seeing that. I would much prefer it to stop right there. And that is a matter of where you position that dowel. You just play around with it. So get a couple of several pieces of scrap and just keep working with it. And you don't have to make the whole box. You just have to have one piece in the bottom and a piece that represents the lid with a section of dowel and just play with it until you get it positioned just right. So that's this axis to worry about. Now, this one. What you're going to put essentially is half of the dowel is going to be in the bottom and half is going to be in the top. But if you do it exactly half and half, what you'll end up finding is this. When you clamp this together, you'll end up having it sprung, meaning instead of having it close at the front, it'll be sprung like that. You don't want that. You want it to sit nice and tight. Well, ideally, I put about 49% of the dowel in the bottom and 49% in the top, which means if you could look in there with the lid closed, you should see just a little tiny gap. Now, one thing I've since realized you could do, if you're afraid that you may have made them too deep, you can always go in before you assemble, and on your shooting board, you can take this area right here. You can take this area down 3 or 4 passes, and that'll provide you with that little relief right in here so that when you close that, it allows for it to come tight up here. So you got to play around with the height of the, I'm saying height, the height of the router bit so that you're not making the groove too deep, and you need to play around with the fence so that you're exposing just enough and not too much or not enough of the router bit, so that you can determine where the center of it is going to be. You got to play around with it. I can't give you a measurement. You just have to figure it out, and then once you did get it, lock it and leave it. Next.
Okay, this one comes from Lock Vetter, and he says, how about those little shell finger holds for opening?
This little thing right here? Yeah, how I do that? Show you. It's real neat. I take a... another great question. I never even thought to talk about that. I think when we shot the video.
Get a close up, Jake, while he's over there.
Jake, any idea where that thing went?
Which thing?
That little thing, you know, whatever it's called. I'll show this one because they can do it. So I'll actually demonstrate this. Okay, here we can do it. You ready? Get yourself one of these little arbors. Or sanding sleeves. So you put your sanding sleeve on there like that and tighten this up. It expands the rubber to hold it tight. Then you put it in your drill like so. I'll use this piece of... I have no room. It's a good thing we're almost done. I would have no bench left. So I'm going to put this...
Very convenient of you to take that one bench dog out.
Oh, what's that doing over there?
You took it out and put it over there.
Why did I do that? the dark ones stay on the one side and the bird's eye ones stay on the other. Now, I would find the center mark. Shoot, this is, I'll do this as if that was going to be the outside. Find the center mark. 4.5 would be 2.25. So there's my center mark. So what I'm doing right now is I am working on this piece. So I've got the edge of my, and I do this when the box is in this condition, right? So I clamp it like that, mark my center piece. Then I take this and I get down here like this. And that gives you your little finger recess so that when you close your lid, you have that. And you can, depending on the angle that you approach it, you can have it look like that. You can even roll it so that you get a little bit of texture this way. I thought I did some that were more of a long, droopy teardrop. Yeah, that one. See how that one looks completely different than this one? And that's how it's done. And then just go in with some really fine sandpaper to finish it off. But
you could just carve that, couldn't you?
I've carved them.
This one?
Oh, yeah. That one was actually carved with a gouge. A lot more work than it's worth. That one is done the same way. And different size sleeves. There's a much smaller one according to the size of the box. And sometimes I don't put them in at all. But it is nice so that people, when they pick it up, they know which side to open the lid. Beautiful piece of bird's eye, by the way. We'll leave a link in there for where you can get the kit. We're going to give away a whack of them tonight, at least 10. Don't forget, what else I want to tell you? Oh, yeah. Please visit my friend's website, PatsSecretGarden.com. Moose is a very good friend of all of my family, and he's just a great guy, and I like to share nice stuff. Now, there's something else I want to show you. So, Harold Snodgrass. Harold was a professional cabinet maker, had a cabinet shop here in Grand Bay. About 4 or 5 years ago, they discovered an aneurysm on the back of his aorta, and they said, don't stress yourself because you might not be around very long. Called me up one day and said, Rob, I got to close my shop. You want to buy my gear? So I bought all of his equipment from him. Turned out that they saved his life, and he was looking for something to do. So he came here one day, and he said, Rob, I'm bored stiff. He says, you get any work for me? So I said, yep, start today. So he's been here ever since. And he makes these for friends, and it's, what does he call it? It'll when the wind blows. When the wind blows, it spins like that. It's made out of cedar, so it's designed to be outside. And we'll draw for that tonight as well. Seeing as the last person, we auctioned it off, and they donated it back in order to raise more funds for the Purple Heart. So tonight we will give that away, and somebody will find that. And it's actually mesmerizing when you sit there and just watch it. Show me how he does it. It's pretty cool. All right, we got time. Where did Frick go? Oh, he's not going to do it here?
Did someone ask for a naughty girl? Hey, it's a little form-fitting.
Are you cold? was not a very good suggestion, Megan.
How are you going to sleep after this?
No. How am I going to eat?
It's not even
donations. It's for the donations. And
people
for the
are now taking their money back.
So we've raised $11,225. So
that could be a record.
Worth it.
Just so everyone knows, it is 71 degrees in here, not 61. All
right. Yeah, get that off. Put on the cat sweater.
Yeah, that's the reason all those donations came in.
All right, we're waiting for you. And let's do it. We got a final question. Any vets to? We'll do one more question. And then we'll start our draw, because the draw is going to take a while. We got so much stuff to give away. Give me another question for it.
Yeah, I got one more.
Shameless promotion, the freaking good barbecue.
Okay. I had one more from the chat, and it's from NJ Kayaker. NJ, New Jersey, I assume. Have you used a different type of wood to contrast the hinge? And if so, do you have an example?
Yes, I did. And no, I don't have an example here. So I built, I have a picture of it. Jake, where's my portfolio? The old one. I built it. Here's right here. I built a cherry chest several years ago, back in 1988, I think. And the base was cherry, and the lid was ash, fiddleback ash. And what I did on the hinge, as you will see, I made the hinge out of, I made a dowel, two dowels, a dowel out of cherry and a dowel out of ash. So then I did one piece, the cherry piece was glued to the base, the ash piece was glued to the top. So it was dark and, dark and light, dark and light, dark and light.
And you did the same finger, you said.
Oh, yeah, this had the same, well, these were actually, these dovetails were left proud and chamfered all the way around. Yeah, and, yeah, finger, carved the finger recess there and also on either side, and then wooden lid stays to hold it up. I still have that chest at home, by the way. That was a Maloof rocker that I built a long time ago. So, yeah, I have done that. Don't do it much anymore. I mean, my time factor is down to just making small boxes. I want to, Ken and I are, and probably Harold will want to do it too, want to spend a couple of nights making some for Christmas. This is just the coolest thing to give somebody to have sitting on their desk. I should give away one of these tonight too.
Yeah, that suggestion was made.
Yeah, actually, you know what?
Hope, I should say they were hoping.
Actually, I'm going to give one away, but that one that I'm making over here out of Baston Walnut is going to be made and sent out to Herman, so he can, if he needs an extra box to keep his metal in, he will have it. So I was working on that today. I didn't get it finished, but I will, and it'll be in the mail, Herman. Thank you. Thank you for being part of our program tonight. It's awesome. Absolutely awesome. So yes, we will give this is actually, this is Baston Walnut as well. Hey, one of the guys taking my class in Seattle gave me that piece of wood. So that's Baston and Bird's Eye Maple. So that'll be on the chopping block for tonight as well.
It will?
What? Yeah, it will. Stingy? Okay. So if anybody wants to make a last donation, we're giving away one Santa Claus. Well, Santa Claus and I are splitting it tonight. We're giving away one kit. For every $1,000 in donations, which, so what are we up to?
We're over 11.
You're giving a lot of kids.
So we're drawing for 11. How many people do we have on? Did we break 1,000?
No, we're close. We're at 948.
Okay, so we're going to, yeah, pretty good probability you're going to win something tonight.
We
so
have,
you, yeah. You put the link on where people had to go in order to register to win.
I have, yeah.
Right?
I'm just going through. I'm deleting the duplicate entries.
Oh, here's what we're giving away tonight.
Don't try it.
Harold's whirly gig. Not really a whirly gig.
No, it's a whirly twirly.
It's a whirly twirly. Cedar. We're giving away the Baston Walnut.
No, that was the one featured that was made in that video.
Oh, yeah. This is famous. This is in the YouTube video on making that hinge. We are giving away the Captain Is Always Right from my friend Moose at Pat's Secret Garden. We're giving away the cat sweater. We're going to give away that shirt, not the one that Frick put on.
It's actually, people are requesting to see the naughty girl again. That request actually comes from your brother, Mike.
Yeah, of course. So we're going to give away a naughty girl t-shirt. And if you want any of those, they'd be a great, great gift. Go to Moose's website. You can get them on there. He ships them right out pronto. And prices are really incredibly good. What else are we giving away?
A whole bunch of kits.
So the sweater, the cat sweater, the t-shirt, the hoodie, the whirly spinner, the box, and 11 kits.
Oh, my word.
Woo! All right, any final thoughts? Ken, did I forget anything? All right, shall we get started?
I'm just getting a lot of last minute ones here.
Super Dave thinks that Frick should do a photo shoot for the website.
Frick, what were you getting into ice cubes out there or what?
It is cold. It is cold. It is Canada in the fall. All right. Sorry. Where's my name picker here? There we go. Okay.
What are we giving away? What are we doing first?
It's up to. It's up to Ken.
Ken, who's keeping track of all this?
Yeah, someone needs to write this down.
I'm having the whiteboard, I can write it down.
All right, let's do Harold's Whirly Twirly first. So pull up a name for that, Frick.
All right, first winner, Whirly Twirly. Simon Niedkowski in Birmingham, England.
Oh, wow.
It's going to be expensive.
Yeah, right. If you want to donate that back, Simon, we'll be... Okay, congratulations, Simon. Next, let's do the Captain is Always Right. Captain is Always Right hoodie, and we'll find out what size you want.
Winner is Brian Fugati from North Dakota.
How do you say it?
Fugati.
I like the Italian pronunciation.
Fugati. Tom, is that, is he related to Tom?
Wow, that's a fancy name from North Dakota.
Isn't that?
No.
No? Okay. Congratulations, Brian. Now for the cat sweater. The cat.
Winner of the cat sweater is?
Dead cat.
Darren Wolf in Illinois.
Darren Wolf. We're contacted, Darren, because I'm sure you're going to want that for the lady in your life. Now, the should we sell it as the one that Frick tried on with the
it comes indented
with the pokies.
Well, if I would have known, I would have put Band-Aids up.
We didn't think you'd need them.
He All said right. they need a Naughty Girl calendar.
That's next. That's going to require 20,000 in donations. All right.
Okay, who's getting the t-shirt?
Alex, I can't even. Afanciev.
I want to see if he gives it back.
Alex Afanciev from Florida.
Alex, down in Florida.
Well, nice and warm. Nice and warm.
The heat of Florida, you won't have any worries. Okay, so right. That's taken care of, right?
What's next?
Now we're on to...
I think we should do all of the drill kits and then do the box last.
Okay. So drill, how many? We're doing 11 drill kits?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. These are the premium ones. That's everything you need except for the actual router. So, drill kit number one.
We got to pop through these, Frick.
Yeah, really quick. Scott Beckstrom from Washington.
Congratulations, Scott.
Number two.
Drill kit number two.
Is Colin Wilson from Victoria, Australia.
Keep going. Colin, congratulations.
Next up is Gerald Tyler from Oklahoma.
Gerald, congratulations. This is four.
Michelle Abyss Jarvis from Ontario, Canada.
Wow, yep. Canadian. Michelle. Number five.
Richard Efting from Discovery Bay, California.
Richard, congratulations. Number six.
George Riley in Texas.
George, congratulations. Number seven.
Should we capture Rob over here?
I have to take my shoes off.
I have the number. You don't have to.
Vidar Sorvik in Norway.
Wow. Vidar.
Going all over the place.
Who is that? He's not their captain. Number eight.
Brian Proffer in California.
Hey, Brian. Congratulations. Number nine.
Number nine is Steve Scope in Ohio.
Steve, congratulations. Number 10.
Michael Doto in Texas.
Congratulations, Michael. And number 11.
Carl Riley, also in Texas.
Hey, Carl. Okay. Congratulations. Last. Now, we didn't happen to get 1,200, did we? Or 12,000, did we?
We did, yeah. Didn't we?
No.
Oh, sorry.
No. Okay. So the last one is for, and it's stamped, but I'll personally sign it with my hot pen. So this is Bastogne Walnut from Bastogne, Belgium, that area, and Bird's Eye Maple from O Canada, and for your business cards. So I'll put mine in there. So here we go. Who gets it?
Dave Avery in Ontario, Canada.
Wow, Dave. Congratulations. In the mail for you on Monday. That's it. Thank you, folks. This has been an absolute pleasure. This will go down as my favorite. And thank you so much for our special guest. It's an honor and a privilege to meet people like that. And to that entire family, we give our utmost thanks. And for all of our veterans. And we will continue to do this through the month of October and November as our way of saluting our veterans and the freedom that they have provided to us. So I didn't do the introductions. I'll do it quickly. Frick, behind the T-shirt and keeping everything working tonight. And Jake, behind the camera. Do a quick spin around, Jake. They always want to see your face. Smile big. Do the spin. There you go. Zoom out. Spin around. Smile. Show your teeth. There you go. And there's Ken. Ken Anthony has been here helping us tonight. Over there in charge of security is my son Rex. Megan, our model. Colonel Luther. Let me talk to Luther. Colonel Luther, thank you. I love you. You did a tremendous job tonight. Absolutely fantastic. And Super Dave, Super Dave's mom, and all of our vets out there, thank you very much. We will see you guys in 2 weeks. Take care.